Hello everyone, Lindsay here, the Frugal Crafter, along with Sarah.
Hello!
And we are here for another live Painting Friday free class.
Yay!
Yay! And we're going to use some colors that we don't typically use. We're going to paint a teacup full of grapes, and I think it's going to be fun because we're going to do a lot of wet into wet techniques that, and do some techniques that I've had people ask me about recently. And we're going to do a background, and Sarah and I were discussing whether we should do the background first or do the focal first, and Sarah made a good point. She said we should do the background first because there's lots of details to get around there. Yeah. And a lot of people ask about that.
Yeah. Hi, Chewy.
I'm using M. Grimm watercolors. They are actually probably my favorite if I had to pick a specific brand. And I hadn't gotten them out in a while, which I thought was kind of alarming. So I figured we would start off with that. And the colors we're going to use are ultramarine blue, burnt sienna, naphthol red, and gamboge, or new gamboge. So that's basically a warm yellow, a neutral, a fairly neutral red, maybe just very, very slightly towards a warm red. Burnt sienna, which is also a nice warm brown. Ultramarine blue is a warmer blue. So these are all fairly warm colors, and they'll give us some nice mixes that are not going to be overpowering. This video is brought to you by jerrysartorama.com. There you'll find links in the video description to all the products that I'm using. I'm actually painting on Arches paper today. I had torn down a bunch of sheets this weekend so that I could do some work with this paper. This is, again, probably my favorite paper, but I'm usually just kind of a little too stingy to use it that often. But then I realized I had 50 full 22 by 30 inch sheets under my bed in my big flat file storage. So I decided that, you know, you can't take it with you. You might as well use some of it up because I probably paint with it quite frequently until I die and still not run out of paper. So we're going to start by wetting the background.
And just a quick reminder too, anyone who does have questions, please remember to type your questions in all caps. It makes it easier for me to distinguish regular chat from questions.
Oh, good idea. And I'll try to keep the questions to watercolor so it's helpful for the people in the replay. But please feel free to chat amongst yourselves on any topic that you like. And I'm using a nice big brush. I'm using a big round brush as opposed to a big flat brush just because I've got so many little details to get around. If you don't have a big round brush, use a big flat brush. You're better off using a big brush to wet this background than fussing around with a small round brush. You can always use a smaller round brush to get into the details, but you got to get the background wet and you got to kind of keep it wet for this technique. Who do we have in the house today? I've been so busy, I didn't get a chance to peek at the chat before.
We got Gracie, JPC13, Valerie, Dominique's here this week. She's been gone the last couple weeks. Jen K, Gail Gasson, Rhonda McGee is here, Teresa Gonzalez.
Wonderful.
We've got a lot of regulars. We've got a ton of new people who are finally caught the show during the live play.
Great.
Erin Hendrick, how do you keep your paper from getting really wet?
Well, I want my paper to get really wet, so I'm putting on quite a bit of water, but if you don't want your paper to get really wet, you can actually keep it dry and paint on dry paper. I do that for some effects, like if I want to keep crisper details, but I usually, while I'm progressing through a piece, I usually start off painting on fairly wet paper, and then I let it get drier as I go so that I can retain more details. I'm not sure if I want to paint all the way up to the tape that I have on my paper, because I think I might want actually kind of a rough edge, because I kind of like that painterly rough edge sometimes. And I think with all the detail we're going to get in the focal area, I think I'm going to want that something a little bit more chaotic on the outside to help balance it a little bit.
Benny Chavez is here, and Ian Jackson.
Oh, hi, guys.
Ian, they're here too. Question I gotta bounce back. Gets a lot of chat going on. Johan Gockel, how do you avoid your paper buckling after adding a lot of water?
Well, today I taped it down because I knew I was gonna do a big wet into wet wash, and I'm working on a large piece of paper. This is 11 inches by 15. It is a quarter of a full sheet of paper. So I know that it's gonna want to buckle if I didn't tape it down. You can also stretch your paper, and I have a video on how I stretch my paper. I used to soak it and then either staple it down or tape it down, but then I realized that I could get almost as good of an effect just spraying it and sticking it down with a gum tape. That way it's quicker. I don't have to find a really pristine, clean tub to soak it in, because I would like kind of scrub my tub and for one sheet of paper.
Scrub your tub.
I'm such a bad housekeeper that, you know, that is enough to make me, you know, want to stretch my paper. But, or, you know, or I'd have like a big wallpaper bin, one of those wallpaper soaking tubs. And I would use that for stretching paper, but it just, it, I find it just as easy to soak it with a spray bottle. And I don't rinse away as much sizing because I like my surface to be somewhat sized. And sometimes soaking it will remove too much of that. So that's what I do. And I have a video on that, how to stretch paper. Search it on my blog or YouTube channel. You'll find it. All right. And I'm just going with another little coat of water here because the first layer sinks in on cotton paper and you need another coat. You might not need to on a paper, wooden paper.
Gracie Shack, what causes some watercolor paints to dry out and crack? And what are the best paints for children?
The amount of filler in watercolor paint, like student grade watercolor paint, is going to crack and dry out in your palette a lot because it has so much filler and also is kind of light on glycerin. So if you add a little glycerin into those paints, they will perform much better. I'm taking some ultramarine blue with my big brush. Oh, and the best paint for children, I would go with probably a Prang if you can get that where you live. It's an excellent children's grade paint. And I knew it. Didn't I say that? My phone was going to ring.
You said, I got to remember.
Yeah, well, I'm going to ignore that and hope the answer machine, I got a new phone system, and I'm hoping the answer machine picks up. Oh, never a dull moment.
Nope.
The kids are having a bunch of friends off the bus today to get ready for the activity night dance, and I'm sure it's probably a parent wondering something.
You'll get back to them.
Okay, so I got a puddle of bright, just ultramarine on its own, and then I've got the ultramarine and burnt sienna to make kind of like a gray. And I'm going to go in with a darker color first, and I'm actually going to paint in some of the shadows in the fabric. And if you look in the video description, you're going to see a link to a beautiful photo by Lillian Bell over on Paint My Photo, and that's a reference photo I'm working from. You can check that out and see exactly what I am looking at if you want to, or you can just follow along. I know that's helpful for some people to have that reference photo right there.
Chris Bushnell, if we had time, could masking fluid be used on the outside of the sketch instead of fiddling around the grapes?
You could. I probably only recommend it just for like the stem. I really don't like to fuss with masking fluid. I don't like to wait for it, I guess. I would just use it for like the smallest details. Some people would mask out everything in the focal point. That's fine if you want to. For me, that's too fiddly, but you totally can do that. And look, even with this big brush, these are the Mimic brushes from jerrysautorama.com. I can get a nice fine point and get in there really well, and it holds so much paint that I don't have to keep stopping to reload, which I really, really like. These are the Mimic squirrels. They have the faux Kalinskis and the faux squirrels. The Kalinskis are snappier. They're a little bit, if you've never used a natural hair brush or a synthetic natural hair, that they're probably better to start off with because these might feel a little unwieldy because of how much paint and water they hold. But for backgrounds, I just really love being able to carry so much pigment over here. I'm getting in my shadows while I'm at it too. So now I'm going to mix that in, mix kind of those two shades together so I don't have super, super bright blue. And I'm going to go in the foreground here to lighten that a little bit.
The Craft Cuckoo. Hi, Lindsay and Sarah. First time I've managed to catch you live.
Welcome.
I have Bockingford Aquarelle watercolor paper, and it seems to soak the water up straight away. Is this normal?
Well, that is a cotton paper. I have Waterford, I think. It's made by the same company. A cotton paper will tend to absorb a little bit more, and different papers have different amounts of sizing in it that will affect how quickly it soaks up water and if your paint can stay on top or if it seeps right in. if it's absorbing and like you go in and do that second coat of water like I just did and it still is absorbing, you might run into a little bit of trouble painting on it. But there is a product called Lift Aid, and you can paint that over your paper and let it dry before before painting, and that can help give you a little more blendability and liftability to your paint. You can try that. I haven't used it because I haven't really had a problem with the paper that I'm using having that issue.
Starshine Soldier. Whoop, chat's crazy. Whoop, lost the question. Has anyone used the Caran d'Ache small marker tip water brush, and what would it be good for?
I have their larger tip one. It would just be good for anything with detail. You know, like coloring stamped images, or anytime you want to bring like water with you, but not have like a water bucket. Like if you're painting in plein air, you just want, it's just a very fine tip. It's the same as the other water brushes. They tend to be more expensive than other brands, but they're good quality. So I would say go ahead and try it if you want. I think if you like a small brush, then it's probably, it'll probably work for you. I prefer the medium to large tips myself on water brushes, but I haven't used the Caran d'Ache small tip. I've just used the larger tip one.
Rhonda McGee, Lindsay was talked about on a show by Marty Owens Gang.
Yes, the Art Posse podcast. I actually, it was funny because I actually heard it and I was completely surprised to get a shout out.
Woo-hoo.
I was like, oh, that's nice.
Tracy Klein, please discuss brush load, my biggest problem. Thanks. Love your videos.
Okay. Brush load. As you can see here, I'm kind of almost using the brush as a sponge, and I'm soaking up a lot of pigment. When I'm doing a background, I want to load the brush with as much as I can so that I don't have to keep stopping. Because every time I stop and I go to reload my brush, I will run the risk of getting hard edges on my painting in that time that I'm away from the painting. So I want to get that background in as quickly as possible so my edges can't dry before I get a chance to come back in next to them and soften them out. So I want a pretty good brush load. Your brushes that are, the regular synthetic brushes are not gonna have as much, are not gonna be capable of as much brush load as your natural hair brushes, or even your synthetic natural hair brushes, like the ones that are just made to act like animal hair. They're not gonna be as absorbent. So depending on what you want, I always recommend beginners start with something that's a little bit less thirsty of a brush, because a lot of times they have a hard time mixing the colors as dark as they want because of how absorbent the brush is and how much water it picks up. Now I'm thinking that I've got some patches of background that are a little bit too streaky, and I'm gonna soften them by just giving it some spritzes of water. Oops, and my sprayer turned around the wrong way. I just sprayed my hand. I spray my reference photo, and then I'm gonna end up with all sorts.
It'll end up with like a little Picasso on you.
Yeah, there you go. Now the good thing about the colors that I used here in the background is that if I did make a mistake and I got in someplace I didn't want to, those colors are very easy to lift. So that's kind of a good thing there. And I think while everything's still pretty wet in the background, I'm going to go ahead and mix up a little bit more of the dark shadow color, which is the burnt sienna and the ultramarine, but with more ultramarine, less water in it, and maybe put a few dark shadows while everything's still wet.
Layla Barazzi, what can you do when your paintbrush doesn't soak up enough water?
Well, you can get a spray bottle like I just did and spray an area. You can maybe find like a big brush. See what you have. Maybe you have like a big soft, maybe even a makeup brush you don't use anymore. Those are very absorbent. You can use that to wet a paper first. And then if you're finding that you're really having an issue, consider getting a brush that is more absorbent, like these Mimic brushes, because they're not very expensive. They do have sets, which I would recommend if you can, if you have it in your budget. But if not, and you just want to pick them up, you know, one or two at a time, I would get like a, maybe like a number 8, anywhere between like an 8 and a 12 round, and maybe like a number 4 to anywhere between a 4 and a 6 round, and then maybe get like a 1-inch flat, And that way you can kind of build it up as you can build your selection up as you can afford it, because it really does make your painting process a lot more enjoyable. And most of us do this for enjoyment. So, you know, just add to your collection as you can afford it.
Teresa Gonzalez, have you done a video on caring for your brushes? I'm having a problem with rust.
Oh my, I've never had a problem with rust before. You know, I don't think I have. I've done almost 1,500 videos. You'd think I would have done a brush care and maintenance one.
Well, you can add it to the list.
Yeah, I'm sure I've mentioned it, but that might be a goose hunt, a wild goose hunt, trying to find.
I'm sure somebody out there somewhere does.
If you're having rust problems, though, I would say don't soak, let your brushes soak and just wipe off the ferrules after you've washed them. Just getting some of these kind of fabric fold lines in here while I'm at it.
Baru Siva, Lindsay, what are the ways to share my paintings with you to get your valuable opinion?
You can post them to the Frugal Crafter Facebook page. It's just facebook.com/thefrugalcrafter. That's probably the easiest way. And if you post it right to the page, you can get other people's feedback too. If you don't want to share it with the world, you can always send me like a private message. I will admit I only get to Facebook probably twice a week.
What?
I know. I am honestly, so don't post something and think, oh my gosh, she didn't get back to me. She hates it. Honestly, I get to Facebook like twice a week. So
I get it to zero times a
week. But you know, I'm kind of excited because YouTube is starting a community tab, and my channel hasn't gotten it yet, but it'll be a place where people can actually post right here.
That's
gonna be really nice, because that way you don't have to kind of hunt down a post, because sometimes I'm like, if somebody emails me something and I don't recognize the address, I mean, it might get caught in my spam filter, or I get hundreds of emails a day. I'm kind of like, I'm skimming through and just scouring the things I absolutely need to read, and I could see how something could get missed.
We have a lot of questions about supplies you're using. Lindsay provides a supply list with links on where to get them underneath the video description. So if you're looking for the size brushes she's using, the paper she's using, it's all listed underneath the video description. And then, like I said, there's links provided. So you can just actually, if you want to purchase it or look at it online, you can just click the link and it'll take you right to where she purchases them.
Oh, there's a big sale going on at Craftsy this weekend. All classes are under $20. And I have a link in the video description. You can click on that. And any classes you buy support the channel, and I really appreciate that. I was looking at the quilting classes. They had a quilt as you go class, and that's kind of my speed.
I was going to say, that's your style.
Yeah, because I lose interest after I make a quilt block, or you know, even a quilt top. It's like, well, I've done the fun part. I don't want to finish it. So that way I'm done. You know, when you're done, you're done. I love it. It looked really good too. So.
Yeah, you can just kind of go do it as you go.
Yeah, and get started on some holiday projects.
Oh, can you believe it? It's time to start thinking about Christmas already.
I know, it's crazy. I am so not ready. I'm just trying to get to the kids' birthdays right now.
Well, thankfully Jackson's a boy, so he's a little easier.
Yeah, that's true. So I wanted to show you about lifting. Like I mentioned, we use colors in the background that specifically will lift if we do make a mistake and get it on our foreground. So when you want to lift up an area, like I got a little background there in that grape, and I can't really paint over it because it'll show through, because the grapes are going to be much lighter. What I do is I wet a brush, and I make sure there's no beads on the ferrule there. So I kind of wipe off those. And then I'm gently going to just paint over that area and just wiggle this brush back and forth. I'm using an acrylic paintbrush, a Simply Simmons. It's a fairly stiff brush, but not as stiff as a hog brush. So then after I've loosened up all that pigment, I can go in with a paper towel and press straight down and really remove most of that stain. I could go back in there again, but I think it's light enough that I can go over it. And I don't want to mar the paper. I just want to do enough abrading to remove the loose paint, but I don't want to go in and make it so the paper is going to accept the paint differently. You might have to go over it a couple times. The thing I actually like this over using masking fluid, because you're going to get a more natural edge rather than looking like somebody just cut out a picture of grapes and stuck it on top of a background, you get more of a natural look, having some of those softer edges. The next thing we're going to do is a wash on the teacup. And we're going to be doing that in pretty much the same colors that we've been using, but we will also have some reflections of the grape colors that we'll be using. So again, our first step is going to be to wet. We're going to wet the teacup, we're going to mix our colors, and we're going to come back and wet it again to make sure that we have uniform wetness on there. So just give it a nice, just be careful because your paint is going to go wherever it's wet. So when you're wetting the area, keep in mind you've got grapes and you've got other things you're not going to want to paint over. This is going to be a pretty light wash, so it's not a huge deal, but just keep it in mind.
Jacques, how do you know what colors will lift or not?
If you, well, I kind of know it just from experience, but if when you're purchasing colors, or you can even look on a website for the colors you happen to own, there'll be information on that, whether the color is staining or granulating. If it's staining, it won't let lift. If it's a granulating color, it will lift. So the type of colors that kind of, you can kind of see texture within their mixes, those tend to be granulating, lifting colors. Your more opaque colors tend to be lifting. Sometimes the cadmiums will stain, like cadmium reds will stain, and those are granulating colors. But generally, earth tones, earthy colors will lift. So just do a little research on the paint that you have, and you can look at the colors, or look at the pigments that are in the paint that you have, and then you can research whether they granulate and will be lifting colors, or if they stain. So if you're trying to do something where you think you might want to lift, avoid the staining colors. All right, so I've done my initial wetting of the paper. Now I'm going to go over to my, like you can see here on my palette, maybe you can, maybe you can't, but there's a lot of texture in here. That's because both of those colors, burnt sienna and the ultramarine blue, are granulating. So they kind of just kind of settle out, and you see all those little particles just settling out. And some brands granulate more than other, depending on how finely they're milled. Like Daniel Smith colors tend to granulate more than other brands. So there we go with that nice gray already on our palette. We're also going to want a little bit of our naphthol red. And I don't think we're going to need any of the yellow. Might want a little bit of burnt sienna on its own. We could do a little yellow in that burnt sienna just so we start integrating all the colors though. So we'll do a little gamboge. Super, super light. You can see how there's hardly, it's mostly water that I have there. This is a white teacup, but as you know, things that are white aren't all white. Come back, we're going to do another layer because you'll probably see if you're using, like with this Arches paper, which is 100% cotton, that first layer has absorbed. If you're working on a like a student paper or wood paper, you probably won't need this second coat. Like there's a paper called Canton Montville, which is a wonderful beginner paper. And one coat on that would be sufficient because it sits on top of the paper more because of the amount of sizing that's in it. So you just basically want a soft, like semi-gloss sheen to it. It'll keep your edges nice and smooth, your blends nice and gradual. Okay, so now I'm going to grab the gray, and I'm kind of rolling my brush in it, so I pick up a bunch of it. And that's going to go, because our light is coming this way. It's coming from that, so I'm trying to bend my arm. I'm using my other hand, that makes more sense. Coming that way. So this side of our cup is going to have more shadow. So we'll go ahead and put that in there. And then to the left of our grapes are going to have a little shadow. And since everything is still wet, everything's blending really nicely. And since this is a cylindrical shape, we actually will end up with a little shadow even on the highlight side just because of the nature of light and form.
Unique Boutique, what are your favorite three brushes for watercolor and acrylic, especially for beginners?
For watercolor, I'd go with a number 8 round, number 3 round, and a number 1 inch flat. And for acrylic, I really don't have favorites because acrylic is not my favorite medium, so I really can't
We could direct her to Cinnamon.
Cinnamon Cooney, yeah.
She is an acrylic master. She yep, would know.
She would. She's got a brush she calls Goldilocks because it's not too soft, not too hard. It's just right. I'm dabbing a little of the Naphthol red around the grapes because that's a reflection because it's a glossy ceramic glazed cup. It's acting like a mirror to some of these colors.
Jennifer Hopping, when you add paint to the mixing part of the palette, do you clean your brush in between colors? It seems like that would be a lot of wasted paint.
I tell beginners too, so they don't contaminate their colors, but I don't always, because if you've got a nice dry like pan of color like I have here, because I've let my paints dry, you're usually fine. But if you've just put that paint out, you want to rinse your brush in between, because it may seem like it's a lot of waste, but if you contaminate a big pot of color, which is like almost a tube of paint, that's way more waste. So I always tell my beginner students to get in the habit of washing between, because then when they get a little more experience, they'll know how much they can do before getting into trouble. Especially my beginner class at the library where we share palettes, because sometimes you have some pretty interesting looking palettes. It's like, I know there was 12 colors in there. It appears like there's only one right now. It's all brown.
Oh, yikes.
All right, so now we've got a nice soft color here in our what's going to be white, but it's actually nice and soft because we've put down our local color. We've put down the influences that this white has. We've got the influences of the blue and the gray from the background. We've got the influences of the light, the creamy color, and we've got the influences of the grape. So we have that all in harmony here. So that's what we're going for, in case you're wondering why we have all those colors in there. And now we're going to mix up the colors for our grapes. So we're going to take the Naphthol red, which is, it's a lovely color. It's almost neutral, I would say, as far as reds go. I mean, magenta's probably like a magenta, yellow, and cyan are your primaries. If you want to kind of use a super, super primary look, but if you want to mix like a printer mixes, like how a inkjet printer mixes, those would be your true primaries. But this red doesn't really lean too much either way. I would say maybe just a shade warm, then cool. But I find that it's going to give us perfect look for these grapes. We're going to take a little burnt sienna, and that's going to warm up our color. So we'll do a little bit with the burnt sienna. And see, that's when I just picked up color there, I knew how dry my brush was, and I knew that the paint would be more likely to leap onto my brush than the paint on my brush was to leap onto the into the well. So it's just something you kind of get with experience, but I'd say until you have that experience, clean your brush in between. And then do a little bit of the blue here in case I want to mix a little of that a little more purpley. Because these are red grapes. And you always think kind of they're a little purpley, but these really are not that purpley, but I just want to have that to cool it down if I need it.
Thomas Schwab, how do you get a straight line with watercolors?
I hold my brush straight up and down, and you might actually want to use a brush that's called a liner or a rigger. And this is what it looks like, and it's got really long bristles because it will hold a lot of paint but allow you to do a really fine line. And sometimes I'll even lay a ruler down kind of on its edge, and I will slide it against a ruler, like if I was doing like the mast of a boat or something like that. We are going to do these grapes, all fairly in a similar fashion, and we're gonna skip around. So I'm gonna start by wetting this little grape back here. And you don't want it puddly, but it's gonna be real glossy because of the way we want our paint to move. And now I'm going to pick up some of my darker red. I'm doing the three colors mixed together, actually, because this is my darkest shadow. And I'm going to drop this in right behind the other grape. So it's going to have its darker shadow right in there. You need to watch a pretty paint move, which it's my favorite thing to look at.
Gail Gasson, does Lindsay get acknowledgement from Jerry's when we buy from them through her?
Jerry's sponsors the video. They pay a flat fee for me to talk about their products, but they continue to sponsor because of you awesome folks ordering.
That's right.
And I mean, they've got like really fancy people that, you know, research things and they can see where you guys are coming from. You can always say I came from Lindsay, you know, if you want to.
Bugging out 45. How many washes do you generally do?
It totally depends on how long I'm going to take on the piece and, that's glare. You guys can't see that, can you? And what it needs, like these grapes will probably not need any additional glazes. We'll probably do each one of these because that looks, gives you kind of that frosty look just by dipping and dabbing in our colors like that. So, but like on this, we're going to need to go over that and do our details, and we might even do a little more glazing on top. We'll see what it looks when we, how it looks when we need it. We'll probably need a little more work in the background, some side loading maybe. So it just depends on what the picture needs and how long I intend on spending on it. And I just noticed I missed a little background area right there, so I'm going to go and paint that in while I still have some of that color. If you notice that you missed any spots, you can go in and fill them in. Hopefully that's dry enough there. It's kind of tricky though, because things dry later. So to get that kind of matching the background can be a little tricky. So I'm going to blot that a little bit because I know it's a little too dark. Okay, so we're going to pick another grape and we're going to wet it. And we're just going to keep on doing that until we have all of our grapes painted. It'll be very exciting.
Layla Barazzi. Hi, Lindsay. What can I do to make my painting look less fussy?
Use a bigger brush.
And walk away.
And walk away. Yep.
Exactly. I'd get stuck doing that when I, any sort of crafty, sometimes I just have to put it down and walk away.
I'm mixing up just a darker shadow color all on its own because I was getting, I decided that I wanted that for whenever I have to go in and put the shadow in. For this, you really are letting the paint do the work.
I know, Chewy. It's hard being Chewy.
Oh. Is she bored? Chewy bored.
Oh, so speaking of which, so she went to daycare yesterday and orchestrated the Great Escape of 2016.
Oh, no.
So apparently, she's figured out how to nudge open the gate because it's, you know, chain link with the latch that goes down that you just push up to open the gate. Well, at daycare, she can reach it. So she's figured out how to nose it open. And so the girl goes, you know, puts the big group of dogs out to play. Customer comes in to pick up their dog. She goes, you know, says hello. Turns around to go get the dog, and all of the dogs that had been out, Chewy had opened the gate, and they had all come in and were just all standing in the room, like, woohoo, yay, woo!
At least they didn't get outside.
No, they didn't get outside, but she got them, because, you know, there's a long hallway, and, you know, the kennels and stuff, and then there's a door that goes out, and it's just a chain link, you know, it's just a gate, you know, it's nothing fancy, but Chewy has figured out how to open it and opened it and led all of the dogs back inside.
Oh my God.
Because
gosh.
She could.
Oh, I'm glad they didn't get out.
Yeah, apparently the girl turned around and there was like 10 dogs just like, woohoo, yeah, running around like in the hallway, just looking at her like, hello.
Oh, Chewy, what a bad dog.
No, she's smart sometimes. I think she just farted though, so that's not nice.
Oh no.
Victor Aponte, Lindsay, what do you do to warm up for a big painting?
I'll do like color swatches just to kind of figure out what colors I'm going to get, what colors I'll mix. That usually gets me ready to paint. I might do like a little, like a pen and ink sketch of what I plan on doing and then do some watercolor washes on top just to kind of get some more feel for it. But generally that's about it. I'm going to try a little bit of that gamboge with that red because I feel like I need some spots that kind of have the light glowing through them over here. And you probably noticed I did three at a time. I wet three grapes and went in with those colors. That way I don't waste so much paint if I go in and do the shadow on each at once and the highlight at once. So I'm not rinsing it all away if I still have paint on my brush. This grape is kind of weird shaped. This is the grape the kids wouldn't eat. It would sit in the bowl because it's not perfect. or it's a little squishy. Gonna wet a few more. We'll do, let's see. If you're curious over whether your painting is dry, just kind of touch it with the back of your hand. If it still feels cool, then don't paint next to that area. So I'm not gonna paint that one because it's right next to that cup where it's still a little bit wet.
Joe Maisky finally got his question through.
Oh, good.
Any tips to turn on a friend to watercolor who's an acrylic and oil painter?
One of those.
One of those people.
Get on a 12-step program. Boy, see, that's kind of hard because it's definitely a personality. I think you people that like watercolor generally have a different sort of personality. I would maybe get them... Show them some control techniques, because that's probably why they don't like watercolor, is that they don't, whoops, I didn't wet that one. They probably don't like the feeling of having no control over the medium. So I would try to maybe teach them how to do like a iris with side loaded petals. Maybe something by, if you look at like Sushi Wee's tutorials, something like that she would do. She does a lot of techniques that are very similar to acrylics.
And just have them watch one of our videos. If they don't fall in love with watercolor, I don't. They're animals.
We'll either convince them or we'll completely put the nail in that coffin.
That's true.
This is not for me.
Layla Barazzi. Lindsay, what exactly is stretching? I keep hearing about it, but not sure what it is.
It is when you wet a piece of watercolor paper and then you lay it down on a board and you tape it down on all four sides with a gummed tape, which is it's like a brown tape that's got dry adhesive on it, but once you wet it, it becomes sticky, and then you let it dry. And so as the paper dries, it contracts and the surface of the paper remains super, super flat. So even when you wet it really with like a big wash, it doesn't buckle because it's been stretched to its maximum capacity. So it gives you a really flat painting surface and it doesn't warp on you at all. It'll be completely flat when you're done. And when you're all done and the painting's dry, then you cut the paper off the board and it'll be super, super flat. And I do have a video on how I do it. I don't soak my paper anymore. I just spray it to stretch it. I find that it's a lot more forgiving and it keeps some more of the sizing in my paper.
Dominique Designs, who's been absent for the last couple weeks. My ink tents always dry so much duller than they look wet and can never get such a clear, vibrant color. Is that just the ink tents?
I noticed that with the blocks, but I don't notice that with the pencils. And I know they say they're the exact same product, but I definitely notice that with the blocks. You could spray them with something, probably like a fixative. I haven't done that because I think it only really, if you framed it under glass, you wouldn't really notice. It's only when you've got that paper right there.
Oh, she uses the blocks, she said.
Yep, the blocks. And I think it's probably whatever they have to put into them to keep them from
crumbling
apart. Yeah, because they don't have the protection of the wood casing.
Dominique said she moved. That's why she was absent the last couple weeks.
Oh, I hope everything's settled down for you.
TB, pros and cons of wet watercolor pigments in tubes versus dry watercolor pigments.
The pros of the tubes is that you can squeeze them into any palette you like. So if you don't like the little pans they come in, you could put them in a big palette like this. Most people like the tubes better. I don't think there's any difference in the paint itself. I think it just is what you like. I mean, the pro would be you could like squeeze out a little bit of paint from the tube and then add water to it, make a huge wash. You don't have to keep like wiping it on the pan to get the color to release. So if you'd like to work larger, that would be a huge pro. I tend to like to work from dry paint because I find it less wasteful. So I squeeze my tubes out into the pan and let them dry.
Thomas Schwab, what is the best watercolor paper?
I really, gosh, there's a lot of really good ones. I like Arches, which I guess is not a correct pronunciation. That's how we stupid Americans pronounce it.
What is the correct pronunciation?
Okay, it's Arch. But whenever I say it, I feel like I'm coughing up a cap hairball.
I feel
or
like
something.
I'm getting over a chest cold. Arch.
Arch. Probably if you say it with a French accent, it sounds super like suave. And
well, I didn't take French in high school. I took Spanish. So the French accent to me is...
I took French in high school, and I can't parlez-vous a darn thing, so...
Parlez-vous!
Yeah, it's, I wanted to speak French really badly, but it just didn't click. I guess I learned too late in life. I don't know.
Well, and I find some people, too, tend to have an aptitude for language. Like, they see... Languages seem to can't come easier than... for some people than others. Yeah.
I even bought some software thinking I would learn how to speak it as an adult. And yeah, that didn't turn out as well as I'd hoped. But to be fair, I didn't really study it that much. So you want to vary your colors as you're going. Look at the reference photo or look at what I'm painting, and you want to leave some areas kind of white because it will give you that illusion of the frosty film that's on grapes. So you don't want to fill everything in, and you want everything to be a little bit different. So so just try to vary it as you go. Don't fuss too long on any one grape.
Mar Art, how do I make my watercolor paintings look more finished without using other mediums like colored pencils?
Glazing. As you work, don't try to paint it all in one go. Try to get like the undertones, and then I'll let that dry, then go over it with more layers and smaller brushes to get detail. I just posted a tutorial on how to paint a blue jay feather, and that has a lot of glazing. And you'll see what I mean. That illustrates a technique that I'm telling you pretty well about just kind of working to build up those colors and those layers, and then it'll give you a much more complete look. And every once in a while, you're going to need to rinse out your brush, because if you just put yellow in the grape and then you're trying to get some like purpley shadows, if you go right in with that purple, you're going to get mud. So you want to do need to clean every once in a while just to make sure that you're going to get nice, clear, bright colors.
Layla Barazzi. Hey, Lindsay. Sorry for bombarding you with questions, but that's what we're here for. But do you have any tips on how to be frugal with paint? I always end up with plenty of spare paint on my palette and lots missing from the cakes. Thanks.
Well, maybe you're mixing up too much, more than you need. So maybe mix up a little bit less, but you can always let it dry and come back to it if you're going to use those colors again. So you don't need to clean it away. A lot of artists don't. I do after I'm done a painting, but you don't have to. I don't know how people can leave. I'm not like a super, neat freak or anything, but I can't leave my palette messy. I have got to clean it up.
We all have those things that you can't stand.
Yeah. I know I see other people's palettes and I'm like, how did you put it away like that? Like, because you're going to have to clean it before you start another painting, or you're just going to end up with this random assortment of colors when you start to paint. But maybe other people don't limit their palette as much as I do per painting. Like, we've got four colors in this painting and that's it. I don't like to work with unknowns. I don't want some, weird random color popping in there that I'm not quite sure where it came from, because then you have this unharmonized bit and you don't really know. You can go in and paint some dry areas with the color if you got a partial area of a grape and you're not, you don't have enough room to really wet it and add the colors. Just kind of fill it in with your darker colors.
Lori Sweeting, what heat gun do you use to quickly dry your watercolor paper? I can never remember the name of the one you have down here.
It's a Marvi Uchida.
Okay. And do you find the heat gun affects the painting at all?
Nah.
Maybe if you hold it too close to the paper, it might burn
You don't want to use it with masking fluid. It will cook the masking fluid. And don't use a hairdryer either with masking fluid. You got to wait for it.
That's good to know. I didn't know that.
Yeah, it'll
not
bake
that
it
I have masking fluid, but
and that's another thing. Sometimes I notice that masking fluid is more difficult to remove off certain papers too. So you know you've got to use a little caution with that. But all right, that one's dry. I can go in on this.
Diana Alvarez, what about layering gives a more finished look?
Well, it's just like if you were going in with a colored pencil, you get to go in and add finite details like the hairs on an animal or seeds on a strawberry or whatever details it happens to be. You're putting more time in and you're putting in a few precise details and it really finishes it off. And plus, then you've got the layers. If you're using transparent colors to layer, which usually is what you want to do, you're seeing that complexity of color because instead of just seeing a mixed color, you're seeing those colors through one another. So it just has a appearance of more luminance, more glow to it. Whereas if you were like in acrylics or oils and you were layering, well, in oils, you could use linseed oil and you could glaze. But if you're like layering in acrylics, you'd be blocking out what's underneath instead of allowing some of that to show through. You can blot any of the grapes you get too dark as well. And that can give it a little bit of a frosty mottled look if you're not able to get it with the paint. I think I want to take a break on the grapes and work on the stem. And I'm going to mix up a color for that. I'm going to use my Gamboge and Brent Sienna. So I get almost like a yellow ochre or raw sienna color.
Do you have videos on glazing, right, Lindsay?
Yes.
Layla's got a bunch of questions about specific questions about glazing, but you do have some glazing videos in your archive, right?
Yes. The raspberry one I did a couple weeks ago has a lot of glazing and the blue jay feather. Those would be probably the best two to illustrate that technique and to practice along with it. They're both real time. They're both about 45 minutes. So you do add quite a bit of time onto the project when you are doing glazes and layers, but it's kind of worth it for the detail that you can get and the finished quality. I'm going into my darker color. I'm just using the tip of this brush, and this is a mix of Brent Sienna, Gamboge, and just a smidgen of ultramarine to darken it. So I'm putting in just the shadow areas. I was just kind of bored with doing the grapes for a bit. So I'm going to let that dry before I glaze over it with a lighter version of that so I keep those shadows. Now I'm going to work on the blue of the teacup. I have to jump around a little bit. Then you get fresh eyes when you go back to look at what you originally were painting. You could stick with a brush this big. This is a number 8, I think. No, a number 12. If you want to, if you're more comfortable going with a smaller brush, then go ahead and switch. Completely up to you. And let's see, I've got that wet grape there, so I probably shouldn't attempt these stripes down the bottom yet. I'm going to see how, yeah, I can get plenty of detail with this. Now you might be thinking, why would you stick with a larger brush if you don't need it, if you can do it with a smaller brush? I like this because this larger brush is going to hold a lot more paint and water because it's got all that area and those bristles to hold it. So that's the, if you're using a smaller brush, you're going to have to go in more frequently and pick up more paint.
Ashley Ruiz, Mission Gold, is it hard to get a natural look due to vibrancy?
I don't think so. You can always add any of its complements to get a softer look. You know, if you had like a really bright orange, you could add a little bit of blue.
Oh, I think the dryer's done.
Oh, that's all right. I shut off the finish guard. I usually forget that. It like beeps every 10 minutes for like 3 hours until I get to... Man, I've been so forgetful lately. I would start a load of laundry and then wander off, let it fill a little bit so I could put the detergent in and just completely forget and just wash a full thing of water. That just kills me because it's so wasteful. But,
oh, yeah.
Oh, my gosh. I was like, what is wrong with me? I'm like having a senior moment. It's too early for this. This is really good for working on brush control. If you do use a larger brush, try to keep it straight up and down. And my hand's probably right in the way when I was doing that. I'm going to tip my paper a little bit so that you can see my hand won't be in the way. Try to do the scroll work in one stroke if you can, because you'll get a much more natural look. How many people do we have here with us today?
We have 311 right now. It was nice. Close to 350 for a little bit.
Cool. Yeah, I think last week's video was the most popular one, like within the first 24 hours. That was kind of cool.
Yeah.
People like the 101 type format, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I want to drag some of this color out so I can fill in some of the flowers, but also keep the lines a little bit darker. And I don't want it to look too fussy, so that's the other thing. So I've got three goals. I want to add some color to the flowers on the cup. I want it to be soft and look like ceramics, but I don't want it to look too fussy. So I'm going to go to a slightly smaller brush, this one right here. And the goal of this is going to be to gently blend up the colors. So I've wet it, and I've just kind of wiped it. I haven't blotted it. I just kind of wiped it. And now I'm just going to kind of wet the insides of some of those petals and let the color flow out. You're probably going to need to rinse your brush here and there, because otherwise you're going to end up everything with a solid color. And you really don't want a solid color. You want it a little bit more glazy looking. And it will dry a little bit lighter, so don't worry about it being too dark. See here, I get more of a solid color because I haven't rinsed my brush. That's all right for these scrolls, but I just wanted to show you what I meant about that. I might actually blot it before it's dry if it seems a little too dark. This one over here seems a little too light. I'm going to go in and add a little bit more color. It's kind of around the edge. It's being distorted a little bit, so we wouldn't see as much detail on this one either. Just give it a quick tap to lighten it up. All right, and we've got a little line up here.
Well, we had our first band, one of our first band people.
Oh, wow. Now, who was the banner?
Well, surprise, surprise, Valerie.
Oh, Valerie.
Cool. Jen got it this time. Jen got it. Usually Valerie is right
on the ball. I was watching another live stream over on...
This particular person was getting mad because you wouldn't answer questions about toll painting when we explain that you don't do toll painting.
Oh. Yeah, try to keep it on topic so it's super useful for the people watching the replay. No, I don't really do... I am just doing the blue, the little burnt sienna to make it more of like a navy, and I'm going to get this line in here. Make sure that you don't have any wet grapes next to this. You can see how it almost looks black there. And you can move your painting so it's comfortable.
Riddhi Verma, who inspired you to go into art the first time?
I don't really remember. I've always liked art, and my parents, recognized I had some talent for it. And there was a nice watercolor artist that lived across the cornfield where I grew up. And she did give lessons. I was younger than what she would take, but my mother showed her some of my work and asked her if she would make an exception, and she did. And I studied with her until I was 13. Her name was Mrs. Turner. And then the rest of that was kind of self-taught. I didn't really have any other formal training. And actually, I didn't really like watercolors that much. When she was instructing me, I wanted to paint with like oils and other more thicker mediums. So I used to use my watercolors very thickly when I was in class. And but then I grew to love the transparency of the watercolor. I guess I just needed something to rebel against at that point.
Ian Jackson, the detail you were putting on the bowl, can't that be stamped on with watercolor paint if you have a decorative stamp?
You could. Yeah, totally. The only thing would be to get the curve, because it's going to be distorted on the sides, so it would maybe look a little flat if you stamped it on there, just because you're not going to be being able to change that stamp into having that distortion that you would see on a round object. It'll probably give you a little more of a collage look, but I think it would be very cool.
Sylvia Costello, would it not be a good idea to set a time capsule for a small piece of art from those who are involved in the art community and have it opened in 30 years?
Oh, wow. That's kind of a cool idea. That is kind of cool. I'm going to do a little bit of a shadow right behind this grape, because I don't feel like I have enough shadow on there to begin with. Yeah, we just opened up a lot. Well, how many years ago was it now? It was a couple of years ago up at Camp Tars, Girl Scout Camp. We opened up a time capsule that was put down back in the 80s. I didn't go to that Girl Scout camp, so it wasn't one of my any of my stuff, but we had one of the moms there was in a Tars camp counselor and Girl Scout camp goer in those times, so that was kind of cool. I always loved the idea of time capsules. You don't hear about time capsules. That seemed to be like big when I was growing up.
Well, yeah, but something only has to be around for 5 years before it's obsolete and old.
Yeah, that's true. What would I put in a time capsule? Open the trendy products or something like that. There are a lot of trendy products, a lot of products that get real, real popular.
Yeah, for 6 months and then they're outdated.
Especially in the craft world, because they need to release so much to
stay relevant. I know I have some paper in my stash that would be considered antique.
Yeah.
Carrie King, how to overcome perfectionism while learning to watercolor?
Oh, that's tough, because watercolor does not lend itself to perfectionism, because there's so many variables and there's so many different ways that a painting can go, just by how wet or dry your paper is, what brand of paints you're using, what the properties of each paint within the series is, because every pigment reacts differently. I don't have the problem of perfectionism, so I don't know how to overcome that. I tend to just kind of take it as it comes. Nobody has to see it. If you don't like it, you can throw it away. Nobody ever has to see how it came out. It's not like playing a piece of music and you play it and it's out there and people hear it. It's, you know, you can fuss with it until you're happy with it, or you can throw it in the trash.
Gracie Shack, are the Turners professional or student grade?
They're artist grade. They're nice. They're really good value for your money, because you get I think it's because, I don't know if they're Jerry's in-house brand, but Jerry's is an exclusive dealer, I think. And they're wonderful. When you can get a 15 milliliter tube for between $3 and $6 on sale, I mean, you can't beat it. I don't know why they're as cheap as they are. There might be some favorable exchange rate wherever they're made. I don't know, but.
Stephanie Soul, how can you tell what watercolor paper is made from?
It usually will tell you on the package. If you've lost the packaging, a lot of times you can feel it when you're painting with it. A cotton paper feels a little bit softer and more absorbent, and wood pulp paper feels a little more slippery. A lot of really good feedback on the keeping the questions to the topic that we're painting with last week.
Well, especially because we have such great moderators. If somebody does have an off-topic question, because they do all do different types of art other than just watercolor. So a lot of times they can guide you, especially like Ian, because he's over in Great Britain. So he can help, especially with the European supply questions, which is awesome, because here in the States, we're like, what?
I know. That's going to be so tricky to be in Europe.
Yeah.
we can take it for granted. We have so much access here. Currently, anyway. I think that because we have quite a few viewers from the UK, I mm-hmm. think it must be we they do. Must be getting out of work. It must be like perfect timing for them.
Yep.
I'd like to do some evening
streams. Oh, that's right. And Gracie's in England too. Gracie and Anne are to Britain. Britain. What's the word? It's the rain. It's resources. Wow.
I have no idea what word you're even going for, so I can't.
Apparently, I had a super major brain fart. Wow. Whew, okay.
That's muddy. That's muddy. I grabbed my stem color. Look at that muddy mess. But look at that. Bye-bye. Easy as pie. Oh, you know what? I kind of like the way that looks. Looks very frosty. I'm just going to do that one, too, because I think it gives it a very grapey look. Oh, I'm kind of happy. It's funny. I have a hard time kind of adjust, like, judging my own work as I'm going, but if I look up at my monitor to see how it's coming, I can get a much better view of it. I'm grabbing a little more of that gamboge on its own.
Yes, Dominique, apparently I do need more coffee. Maybe I'll splurge and go to Dunkin' Donuts.
Ooh.
Ooh. Ooh.
I wonder if they have Dunkin' Donuts all over the country, if that's just a New England
thing. No, they do not. Because when I went to visit John in Texas when he graduated from boot camp,
yep.
Starbucks.
Ooh.
No, there was one Dunkin' Donuts in an airport, and that was it. It was all wow. Starbucks. I was like, no, I don't extra. I want my Dunkin' Donuts back.
I thought America runs on Dunkin'. So
they do, but only past a certain point.
Huh. Well, it's like there's no AC Moores in the West, right?
No, there are not. And also, there's no Tim Hortons, like, in the central part of the state. They're all close to Canada.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because Tim Hortons is Canadian, eh?
Hey.
Carrie King, where does Canson XL paper compare to the other papers you use?
Canson XL is a wood-based paper.
I can't reach you if you're...
So, and it's fairly smooth, so that's something to consider. I really like it for stamping because it's smooth enough to get a really good rubber stamp impression. I like it for swatching up my materials and doing quick paintings, but if you're going to work over an area multiple times, it's going to pill eventually. So you do have to be mindful of that.
Marcia Wolf, can you suggest a good resource, preferably video, for learning about shading?
Craftsy has many how to draw classes. If you click the link in the video description, you can go over there. Everything's under $20 right now, and they've got some really in-depth classes. I just signed up for one that was, it's colored pencil and ink wash, and I've never seen those two mediums used together, so I'm really excited to give it a try. But they have straight drawing. They have a whole drawing department, so I would see what they have.
Oh, they have a Dunkin' Donuts in Manchester City, Gracie says.
Really?
Yeah.
That's funny. Yeah. I wouldn't think they'd be over
love
there.
Dunkin' I don't eat the donuts, but their coffee's awesome. Chewy, I can't reach you. Chewy wants a belly rub, but she's way...
Oh, my God.
Not ladylike at all.
Not ladylike, Chewy.
No. No. Anne Burns, could we see the reference photo from time to time?
You'll have to click over on the link because I do not have the right to share the photo. I have the right to paint from it, but the photographer, I don't have the copyright on the photo. That belongs to the photographer, so you'd have to visit the Paint My Photo link. It's free. It's free to be a member at Paint My Photo. It's a wonderful site for free reference photos for artists, but I can't share the photo because it's not mine to share.
Rajashree Ghosh, have you painted something else with your Senlier paints? Love the feather tutorial.
I did some sketches out at the ball field, but I haven't done more than that, just the blue jay feather. And then, oh yeah, I did a geranium on the channel using those. I think I would definitely grab them if I'm going to do a lot of layering. I just haven't had a lot of layering projects going at the moment. I can go into with a on the dry paper and fill in little sections where there's more grapes kind of in the jar. That way I don't have to wait for it to dry, and you wouldn't necessarily see the frostiness on that because it's all in shadow. So you can go ahead and do that. With a smaller brush, it doesn't hold quite as much water. So if you're looking at the Mimic brushes, the Mimic Kalinskis are less absorbent than the Mimic Squirrels.
Jesse says that the Tim Hortons in Canada and the Tim Hortons in the United States are not the same.
Really? They're
different. Yeah. I actually don't go to Tim Hortons because they made me really mad one time. I went to order a breakfast sandwich at 5 o'clock in the morning and they told me they didn't have breakfast sandwiches yet.
What? It was too early for breakfast sandwich?
You're open and your breakfast, and they wouldn't make me a breakfast sandwich, and I was on my way to work. So I had to leave with no coffee, and I didn't have to. I chose because I didn't want soup at 5 o'clock in the morning or a grilled cheese sandwich. But they wouldn't make
they
me
had grilled cheese sandwiches in the morning,
or what? No? I don't know where it was, like some type of sandwich, but they wouldn't make me a breakfast sandwich because they didn't start serving it for another half an hour. I was like, but I'm on my way to work, and I just want some coffee and a bagel belt, and they wouldn't do it for me.
Rude.
So I've not been back since. It was very disappointing.
I often, because I'm kind of particular about my coffee, so I like Starbucks just fine, but I'm very particular, and I don't find that many places make coffee the way I like it.
Mm. I rarely get coffee. It's like a splurge. I usually just make it at home.
Me too. Although I will, so Starbucks has the soy lattes, and that's worth the $5 and probably 800 calories or whatever.
Yeah, horrible. How often do you have one?
Maybe once every couple of months.
Yeah. See, my brother-in-law, Andrew, is a Starbucks. He and his fiance, they are Starbucks people. That's where they prefer to go. Which is always fun if John and I are in a car with them. We always have to make two stops for coffee because John and I are Dunkin' Donuts people, and they are Starbucks
That's
people.
Funny. What kind of people are you? Starbucks and Dunkin' Donuts?
We're related? I don't think so.
It's like two different political affiliations.
It is. It's like Democrats and Republicans sitting in a car together.
And yet you get along, so that's good. Now I'm going to glaze over with a lighter wash of that mix, which is the gamboge, the burnt sienna, and a smidgen of the ultramarine blue. And I'm just going to fill in any of the stems. Got to get cooking on this. I've got a set out food and I have to I vacuumed, but I didn't bother mopping because I knew that Chewy would probably be here and it was raining out, so. And I hate to mop the floor right before a bunch of kids come over.
Oh, there's no point.
I got a pinata I gotta fill.
Ooh.
The jellyfish pinata I made. I'd have a tutorial for it. So that's gonna get filled. I don't know where we're gonna hook that up if it's still raining. I guess we could put it where the punching bag is down here, and they could...
That or the doorway in between the living room and kitchen.
Oh, I don't think I want them swinging bats upstairs.
Oh, that's true. There's lamps and stuff nearby. Never mind.
It is a pull-style one, so that you could pull it and release the candy, but I don't think they're going to go for that.
No. No. Lois Brooks, do you like painting faces in watercolor?
Yeah. I don't do it very often, but I do enjoy it. Okay, so now I'm just thinking that I want maybe some more shadows on the fabric in the background, and I'm going to move over to a flat, and I'm going to mix up a nice wash of that dark blue. So it's ultramarine and burnt sienna. I'm not going to do a ton. I basically just want to make a little more richness in the background. Especially around the focal point, so I can bring those colors in there too. Why not? We'll get everything in there so it goes.
Oh, no. Minimize the page by accident. Whoops, wrong button. There we go.
That's okay. Ooh. We're still broadcasting, it says. So.
No, I just minimized it by accident. Hit the wrong.
Okay. Clean off my brush as well as I can after mixing that up. So one of the ways I like to do shadows is to side load. So I rinse my brush off well. I might blot it But a lot of times with watercolor paper, I notice it just absorbs the paint a little bit quicker. So then what I do is I turn my brush sideways and I lay a side in the paint and just absorb as much as I can into that wet brush. And because the bristles are wet, it's going to gently let the color kind of feed out. So let's say I want to put a shadow fold back here. See, it just gives you a nice natural kind of blended fold in the fabric. And I can continue it over there if I want.
Dominique Designs, is a small set of Koi watercolors for $25 a good deal?
Is it the pans or the
tubes? She doesn't say.
Because you can get the set of like 30 or 24, 24 or 32. I'm not sure. It's a bigger set. You can get those. The regular price is like 30, and then I've seen them on sale for like 20. So I think I would probably get that. Mm. Although there's probably a lot more paint in the tubes versus the pan sets. I haven't used the tubes, though. I do like the pans. I take them on location painting quite a bit. I'm just defining some of the...
pans, she says.
Yeah, I don't think so. I think you'd be much better at look around because you can find the... you can find the 24 set for that price. Want a little more color in that one there. So I rinse my brush. Anytime the paint has creeped all the way around, I just rinse it off. Go. Is Chewie upstairs?
She is. The cat food's up. I blocked the cat box. She's probably just hoping she can...
Oh, I just heard some noise and I was like, oh, is somebody up there?
She is. She's probably just trying to sneak on the couch.
That's okay. She's fine. A little bit of a shadow under there. I need to mix up a little bit more of that. I'm going to go right ahead. So more ultramarine. And burnt sienna. Try to squeeze off as much of the extra paint on my palette so I don't waste it before I give it a brush. Any other questions popping up in the chat?
Well, I'm a little... We've had some, but our fabulous moderators are really taking care of a lot of stuff.
You can see how you really do get a nice blend just by side-loading in there. Just make sure you... If you're not cleaning your brush in between, that you check and make sure that you've got the right side, the right color on the right side. And if you get too much, you can always go in with a wet brush and soften things out. Remember, you're only adding color to one side of the brush.
Oh, Gracie says don't splatter.
I'm actually not planning on splattering this one. Okay, so you can fuss with the background a little bit more if you want to, but in the... nature of getting this done in a fairly efficient sort of time, I'm going to go and add some more details on the stem around as they attach to the grapes. So I'm going to do with the burnt sienna and maybe just a smidgen of the gamboge and just a little touch of the blue. The red in the burnt sienna helps keep it from going green.
Joe Maisky, thanks for showing us this, Lindsay. Drapery is challenging for me to conceptualize.
Oh, you're welcome. Yeah, have fun with it. It's a really fun process.
Kathy Brenneman, hi, Lindsay. Do you ever donate any of your artwork to hospital, doctor's offices, children's centers, or for auction to raise money for charity?
I have donated some to charity before. I last year did the Maker's Care with woodworking for Mere Mortals, and sold the painting for $160, and I was sent that all to Make-A-Wish. And there's a charity around here called Spruce Run, which is a woman's home, and I usually donate a few pieces for their auction every year.
Lexi Galloway, why aren't you painting to the edge of the tape?
Because I kind of wanted a rough edge instead of a smooth border. So that's what I was thinking when I did that. Might have been prettier with a solid border, but it doesn't matter. I'd probably cover that with a mat anyway. But I thought it might be kind of cool looking because I have the deckled edge where I tore the paper.
David Sackville, skin tones are usually...
It really depends on the skin. Like, you can get a lovely, like this color, the Naphthol Red in Gamboge make a really nice kind of rosy peach there, but it just depends on who you're painting and how their lighting is, and there's so many variables. Okay, so now I think I want to just scrub out some highlights on some of these grapes, and I'm going to go back to my acrylic brush and a paper towel. Make sure you have a nice dry spot in your paper towel or get a fresh one.
Always have paper towels nearby.
Yes. Okay, and I'm just going to scrub out some highlights. All these colors are fairly liftable, so the naphthol might stain a little bit, but nothing too major. Also, if you have any paint that traveled where it shouldn't have, you can scrub it, like the ultramarine I just removed there.
Lois Brooks, do you think 40 pounds, which according to Valerie is between 50 and set, is a good deal?
I do think that's a good deal. I need a half inch flat. I'm just going to grab one.
Carrie King, can liquid latex be used in place of masking fluid?
I don't know. Masking fluid is a type of liquid latex, but I don't know if they do anything else to it to make it more removable. I'm just using a half inch angular. This is a Royal Majestic. I do like these because they have a plastic handle that if you forget it in the water, it will not be ruined like this. Oh, I left that one in the water. And I'm going to pick up some of these grape colors here, and I'm going to actually I better mix up a little bit more because I'm running low. Mix up a nice shadowy color. I'm going to do the Naphthol Red, Burnt Sienna, and a little bit of blue. So there's my shadow. Clean up my brush. I'm just going to get the tip. The nice thing about the angles is that you can always tell where you've put your paint because you just put it on the pointy end and it's a little easier to control. And these are synthetic, so they're not going to hold quite as much paint, but I can use this to go in and add bits of shadow.
Starshine Soldier, does it feel very different using the M. Grahams today instead of the Turners, or are they similar?
No, it doesn't really feel that different. I think I have a lot more colors in M. Graham, but I find them to be, they're pretty comparable, actually. The Gamboge in Turner is really nice. They're permanent Gamboge. I think the M. Grahams are probably a little bit more pigmented, but they're both pretty transparent and nice colors.
Kathy Brenneman, when you paint, do you enter a zen zone at times?
Oh, yeah. That's why you don't hear me talk for a while sometimes.
Just get into it.
Yep.
Rysand, if you had to guess, how many different brands of watercolor do you have?
Oh, gosh. I would guess probably about 20.
NK Nana 3, help! Accidentally dropped water on my painting, blotted it with my paper towel, and it lifted my paint.
I would let it dry completely and then wet the area and repaint it. If it's like a small area, if it's a background, maybe you could put like a shadow in there. So this side loading I'm doing here is helping separate the grapes from one another and helping giving them a round appearance because I'm just kind of going along the contour of it. So as a goal on the contour, it just gives you that feeling that it's a little rounder. And as long as my bristles don't split, I know that I have enough water in there to complete the stroke that I want to do.
Thomas Schwab, how do you keep watercolors from getting muddy when painting?
Limit your palette. I only have 4 colors in this whole painting. So if you limit the amount of colors you're starting with and you choose single pigment colors, then the colors are just going to be more clean. When you have mixed pigments or convenience colors, they're already starting not at their most pure and concentrated and most vibrant level. They're starting already mixed down a little bit. So you lose intensity every time you mix 2 colors. And so if you start off with single pigments, you're going to end up with brighter mixes and cleaner mixes. You can't mix other colors. It's just, you know, if you want vibrant colors, you have a lot more control. So you can always dull down a color, but you can't always bring it back up. And I'm just going around a few of these colors and just kind of adding the shadow. And I don't know if you can notice, because you've been watching right along, but they do get a little bit more round and a little bit more defined as we go around and do this last little shadow. And I think we'll probably call it a day on this picture. I had a lot of fun painting it. The photographer is Lillian Bell. I've painted at least one other of her photos from Paint My Photo. She's a beautiful gallery. And check it out. Leave her some love. I'm sure she'd appreciate it. These photographers share their work out of the goodness of their hearts. And without it, a lot of us artists would not have royalty-free images that we could use. Mm. You can tap on the paint if you want a little bit of that texture that the grapes get with that waxy kind of coating. Bloom. I don't know what you call that when they have that little bit of a bloom to them.
I don't know. I'm sure there's a technical term.
There's always a technical term.
Apparently, I can't think of basic words today. So
yeah. So there's no technical terms going to be happening here.
I'm just going to sit quietly over. Well, I'm just going to sit over here and answer questions, not quietly.
That's all right. I'm just going to mix up some mud here, and on this flat brush, go into my stem, and this will just help me give some barky, choppy texture to it, because I can't get too smooth and fussy with it if I'm on a flat brush like this. Just tap in some more shadows, and there we have it. I hope you guys try this, and I hope you enjoyed the tutorial. I might go in and pull the color all the way out to the edge. I'm not sure. I'm really not sure if I want to keep it rough like that or not. But if you have any questions, you can always pop them into the comments after the live stream is over. I want to thank you guys all for being here. I do appreciate it. And if you're looking for any of the supplies that I used today, please check out our sponsor, jerrysartorama.com. There is a full supply list, including the colors that I used, in the video description. And if you are looking to try something new, check out Craftsy's sale. There's a link in the video description. All classes are under $20, and you can try something new. There's cooking and sewing and cake decorating and quilting and painting and paper crafts and jewelry making. A great way to get started on your holiday making. I want to thank Sarah for being here today.
Hello, goodbye, farewell. I gotta go help move a motorcycle.
Oh, don't hurt your back. God help us. And thank you guys again for joining us. Please give us a thumbs up before you leave and share it with your friends. Thanks so much, and until next time, happy crafting.